are celebrating Resurrection Sunday. Jesus Christ is risen. He is alive. Come on, give someone a high five beside you and say, he's alive. He's alive. Jesus is alive. Wow. This is Easter Sunday, Resurrection Sunday. Thank you so much for joining us here at New Life Community Church. I know there's a lot of smoke in here. We did it because some of you are not used to church. You're more used to the bar environment, so we wanted to make you feel at home. I hope you're feeling a little bit more comfortable here. It's so good to be here. Today, billions of people from high, ornate Gothic cathedrals in Europe to little thatch roof chapels in Africa to the house churches in China to the converted factories at 51st and Keeler. What joins those billions of people together on this day is that 2,000 years ago, they went to the tomb, and something amazing happened. The tomb was empty, marking the real beginning of Christianity. And so we celebrate the fact that Jesus, there are no bones of Jesus in a grave. Jesus is alive and well today, moving with power and might. That's what we celebrate. And so I have a brief message. I think we could already dismiss and go home right now because it was so powerful, the drama. But I decided I would preach a brief message to follow up. And I've entitled my message, What Should I Do? What should I do? Have you ever asked yourself that question, what should I do? Have you ever been in a situation where something tragic happens or something unexpected happens and you say, what should I do? When we first moved into this building here, this is an 84,000-foot converted factory, and we were trying to save money in the beginning when we went to remodel it, and so we mustered up all the volunteers we could get to do the demo. And so in this very auditorium where you're at, we had women and children and young people all with hammers, tearing down drywall, moving stuff out because we wanted to save some money. We probably had about 100 people doing demo. And someone came up running up to me. I had my hard hat on and a hammer, and they came running up to me and they said, Pastor, what should we do? I'm like, what should we do about what? Pastor, what should we do? And I said, I have no idea what you're talking about. And they said, we hit a gas line. Yeah, that's what you get when you get amateurs, right? Volunteers. We hit a gas line, and the gas line went psss. And so I said, get them out of here. And so we just said, hey, everybody out of here fast. We want fire from God, but we don't want a natural explosion to eliminate the church before we ever get started. And so we were able to clear people out, find the gas valve, turn it off. But I remember how emphatically this person looked at me and said, what shall I do? The Apostle Peter preached a message after Jesus Christ was crucified. And after he had risen from the grave and the tomb was empty, thousands of people gathered together at the day of Pentecost. And Peter got up and he spoke the story of Jesus. And at the end of his short message, he made this significant, powerful point. He said, you crucified Jesus. And he was the Messiah, the Christ, the Savior, the God, you crucified Jesus. Now, I know it's easy to look back 2,000 years ago and look at those Roman guards and say, man, those were nasty Roman guards. They did a great job, didn't they, man? I told them, yeah. I said, I'd hate to be Jesus under you guys. You look like you're enjoying that whipping too much, like a little too much. But some people blame it on the Romans. Yeah, it was the Romans who nailed the nails into the hands of Jesus and into his feet. They hoisted up the cross. Others blame it on the Jews. No, it was the Jews. They came before Pontius Pilate and they said, crucify him. Crucify him. Others say, no, it wasn't the Jews. It was Judas. Judas is the one that sold Jesus out for 30 pieces of silver and gave him that kiss of betrayal. And so we could blame it on the Jews. We could blame it on the Romans. We can blame it on Judas. But what Peter got up and told these people, many of whom were not at the crucifixion, had not done the betrayal, had not hoisted Jesus up, but he looked at the Jews and he said, you crucified Jesus. Let me tell you something today. I crucified Jesus. You crucified Jesus. You say, Pastor, I wasn't even there. This happened 2,000 years ago. Don't be blaming me. I mean, people blame me for a lot of things, but don't be blaming now Jesus on me. Theologically, the crucifixion of Jesus was not because of the Romans or the Jews or Judas. The crucifixion of Jesus happened because God the Father looked down upon humanity and he realized that all of us have sinned and fall short. That there was no one, not even one person, that was good enough to make it before him. That we all fell and we all fell short and we all sinned. And so it was because you and I sinned that Jesus was crucified. So technically, although you were never there, although you weren't even born, the fact that you have sinned, the fact that you have fallen short, the fact that you've envied, lied, had pride, had egotism, the fact that you and I are sinners, it is our sin that caused the crucifixion of Jesus. Turn to the person beside you and say, I crucified Jesus. You see, until you realize that it was you and I that crucified Jesus, there'll never be the urgency to say, what shall I do? Until you're aware that you've done something bad, you never ask that question, hey, what shall I do? My brother was pulling out of his driveway and had a couple of the kids in the car. And as he pulled out of the driveway, he felt a little bump, went over a little bump. And he pulled out into the street and he looked back and they were waving at him. He was ready to take off. He didn't know he did anything wrong, but he had just run over the household cat. I'll spare you the gory details. He was guilty, but he didn't know it. He had killed the cat, but he was unaware. He was almost like a hit and run. And I want to tell you something. Many of us here today, we crucified Jesus, but some of us haven't even realized the fact that you and I crucified Jesus, that it was our sin that crucified Jesus, that we, in our condition, created the circumstances that led to the cross. And the Apostle Peter stands before this audience of thousands of people, and he explained to them, you are responsible for the death of Jesus. And the Bible says something interesting happened to the crowd. They were there, and for the first time in their life, they realized, yeah, we are responsible. And it uses this word. It says, and they were cut to the heart. It means that they felt the conviction, that they finally realized, I am guilty of crucifying the Son of God. We were responsible for the death of the Messiah. You see, my concern about Easter and what I worry about Easter is that Easter would be in your life just one more religious tradition. It would be a day where you dress up your little girl in her frilly dress and take pictures and post it on Instagram and say, "Happy Easter, wasn't that cute?" Or that on Saturday you take all the kids and the grandchildren out for a Easter egg hunt in the park district and they run around and fill up their basket and it's a great little tradition and you say, "Wasn't that fun?" Or that after service today, you'll gather together with your family members and friends and they'll take off their ties and get in their more comfortable clothes and you'll enjoy a meal together and have a family gathering together and say, "Hey, that was a fun Easter." But my concern is that a religious tradition or celebration does not translate into life transformation. You see, the message behind Easter is so compelling, so powerful, that it cannot be relegated to a religious day of celebration or tradition. It's much more powerful and personal than that. Yeah. We have to be cut to the heart when we finally realize I am responsible for the crucifixion of the Messiah. I personally am responsible for the crucifixion of Jesus. So what shall I do now that I know he was crucified because of me? And that's exactly the question that Peter answers. And when Peter gets up and answers this question, he gives them two steps that they are to take. Two steps. Number one, he says, repent. If you look at this verse in Acts chapter 2, verse 38, after they said, "What shall we do?" Peter said to them, "Repent." Now, you may have heard that phraseology before, repent, and not exactly understood what it means. You see angry people with signs that are screaming and saying repent, but you're not really sure. What does repent mean? Repent is a biblical terminology that means there has to be a change of mind and a change of heart that leads to a change in behavior. Repent means that we are going down a road, following our own course and our own path, and suddenly we come to the realization that this path is not God's path, that this is not the best path, that we have missed our turn and we're going down a wrong road. And so repent means that I have a change of mind and a change of heart that leads to a change of action, and I make a U-turn and I decide, hey, I'm going to go in a different direction because I've realized I've been going down the wrong road. That's what repentance means. The Bible says they were cut to their heart, and Peter said the first thing you do is repent. Now, why would you want to turn around your life? Why would you want to go in a different direction unless you first of all realize I'm not on the right road? I woke up at 3:30 in the morning this morning. I'm not sure why. I normally don't wake up at that time. Briefly, I woke up wide awake, and I prayed for you. And I prayed that this wouldn't just be another Easter. I was studying this passage and I prayed, God, there are some people that are going to be there this morning that need to be cut to their heart, that need to have this conviction that, hey, what am I doing with my life? Why am I going down this road? Why am I living the way I'm living? Why is my path not in line with God's path? And that there'll be a wake up to say, I don't want to live my way anymore, contrary to God. I realize that my way is not God's way, that my path is not God's path. And so I'm willing to have a change of mind that leads to a change of heart, that leads to a change of action. And I'm willing to say, I'm so convinced about this truth that I'm willing to turn around and go in a different direction. Listen, I know that most of you are here because in one way or another, you embrace Christianity. Maybe you were raised in a tradition that's Christianity-based, and you felt like, hey, on Easter I should acknowledge my background and celebrate Easter. But if your Christianity is not influencing your life Monday through Saturday, then your Christianity hasn't gotten a hold of your life the way that God wants it to. Because it's not about a religion. It doesn't matter to me if you were raised Catholic or Methodist or Baptist or Assembly of God or Presbyterian or Pentecostal or whatever your background is, unless you have a compelling, powerful relationship with the living God that turns your life around, then you have missed the mark. Peter says, repent. Repent. We have to be willing to believe it enough that it causes us to live a different way, to turn around. To say, I'm wrong in the way that I'm living. It doesn't match with the Bible and God's way. What is the definition of sin? The literal definition of sin is to miss the mark. You're shooting at a target and you don't hit right in the middle. That's the definition of sin. The second thing that Peter says to them is not only do you have to, in order to repent, you have to believe, repent, turn around, be willing to go in a different direction that's God's way. Then the second thing that he says to them is very simple. He says, be baptized. He says, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ. Now, what is baptism? Baptism is the physical manifestation of an inward decision that we've made. Baptism is to the Christian what marriage is to the dating couple. It's not baptism that changes you, but it's baptism that says to the world, this is the decision that I've made. If you've been dating a guy for 10 years, and he keeps saying he's all into you, and it's you and I, babe, and we're in this together. And when you say, he says, I'm working on it. But if he's been working on it for a decade, come on, a decade? And every time you bring it up, he gets real nervous and says, I gotta go work on the car. I gotta go see my grandmother. I gotta go see an uncle. And he starts getting out of there. Listen, after 10 years, he's avoiding commitment. He already knows who you are 10 years later. So after 10 years, if he's unwilling to make a commitment, listen, you know what I do is like this, boom. Because he's unwilling to say, yes, I'm in it all the way I make a commitment. Baptism to the believer is the public sign to say, I am a follower of Jesus. Jesus got baptized when he was 30 years old. And they go into the water, and it symbolizes that as you go into the water, that your old self is dead, is gone, is buried. And as you come out of the water, it's symbolic that your new self is alive in God, that you've been washed and cleansed and made new. And that's exactly why Peter says, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus. So when I come to God, realizing that I can't save myself, that I need a Savior, that Jesus was a Galilean peasant, but more than a Galilean peasant, that never traveled more than 60 miles away from where he was born, never traveled internationally, but that he came with a purpose, had a public ministry of 3 years, had a band of 12 disciples that followed him, but he came with a purpose, and it was the exclusive purpose of dying on a cross because you and I needed someone to pay for our sins because we could not pay for our sins ourselves. We were not good enough. So therefore, someone had to pay the price that you and I could not pay, and it could not be someone else that sinned. It had to be the sinless Savior, God himself, manifest in man to pay a price that was too big for you and I to pay. That's the essence of the gospel. And to prove that he was sinless, on the third day, Jesus rose again. When you believe and repent and surrender your life to God, and are willing to take a public step of a believer's baptism to tell the world, I am a follower of Jesus. This is the choice that I've made. I've invited him to change me from the inside out. Then two compelling things happen in your life. These two things that I'm about to reveal to you are at the core of what some of you today walked in desperately, desperately needing. There are two things that happen. And these two things, you may not be able to articulate it clearly what they are because maybe you're not familiar with theological terminology, but in your heart you feel it. You know, this, I desperately need these two things in life. One is cleansing, and two is power. The Bible calls it forgiveness. It tells us in Scripture that if you repent and believe and are baptized in the name of Jesus Christ, it's for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Can I talk to you for a second? This is really, really important. There are people in this auditorium that you walked in here today feeling, I'm unworthy to go to church because I have a lot of garbage in my life. There are people that when we sung, you felt shame instead of love and grace because you feel like you have a list of stuff that cannot be washed away. There are some of you that live with it every day, that have a difficulty relating to God because you feel like you're stained. You've done things that haunt you. Maybe you got two abortions that no one really knows about except the boyfriend that walked off and left you. But it haunts you when the date comes by and you remember, what did I do? Maybe you've thrown yourself into a party scene trying to get that high, trying to feel good. And at the beginning, it felt pretty good to get out and have a good time. But now it's lost its excitement and flavor. Now you go out, but on Saturday morning, you're empty again, wondering if you've caught an STD. Maybe you're here today and your family's crumbled because you couldn't be faithful to your wife. And so she left you. The kids know about it. There's a mess around your house. Craziness that's there. You've really blown it, and you feel like, how could God ever receive me, accept me, or forgive me? I've had people come to me and say, Pastor, I don't think God could forgive me. I've committed the unpardonable sin. I had a guy stop me in the hallway a while back. And I said, how you doing? He said, I'm struggling. I said, why? I didn't really know him. He says, because I don't think God can forgive me. I said, I believe that God can forgive anything. He said, no. He said, I killed a man. I wanted to say, it wasn't a pastor where you're not into like, pat him down, see, you're not loaded, are you? No. He said, I killed a man. I don't know if feel like God could ever forgive me. I said, you know what? If the blood of Jesus Christ can't forgive a murderer, then the blood of Jesus Christ is not enough to forgive anything. See, the power of Jesus, I want to tell you this. There is no sin that cannot be washed and cleansed from us. The only unpardonable sin, the only one unpardonable sin is to reject the Savior that can heal you and forgive you. That's the only unpardonable sin, is to refuse the forgiveness that comes through the cross of Jesus. The Bible says that you repent, believe, when you submit yourself to Him as Lord and say, Lord, you take my life. I'm living the wrong way. Then forgiveness is washed upon us. And I want to tell you something. Listen, some of you don't really feel like you need to be forgiven that much because you're not aware of how much you sinned. I run into people all the time that they tell me they're good. I'm a good person. But how many of you know that good is relative? I think I'm fast if I run against the kids in Sunday school. But put me up against an Olympic runner and I'm slow. You think you're good when you compare yourself to people on death row in a prison. But God's comparison is to his own holiness. The standard of God is his holiness. And if you are godlike in holiness, then you have met the standard. But if you are not, then you fall short. The Bible says, for we have all sinned and fall short of God's glory. And I did the math a while back and I realized we really sin a lot. There's 365 days in a year. And let's say that you only sin three times a day. Now, you got to be pretty good to only sin three times a day, right? I'm talking about a thought, a lust, a lie, ego, pride, blow up, call someone a name. Someone cuts in front of you. Some of you, just on your way to work, you already sin about seven or eight times because, you know, this, that, calling, cursing. I mean, by the time you got to work, you racked up about 100 already. But let's say you're really, really good. Really, really good. Like Mother Teresa's cousin good. And you only sin three times a day. That means that in a year you would have sinned 1,000 times. And if you're here and you're 35 years old, that means that by the time you're 35 years old, you will have sinned. Say as a baby, you don't sin a lot, right? Because you're a baby, you can't sin. But you make up for it in your teenage years. You double, triple, quadruple it quite a bit. So by the time you reach 35, if you've been Mother Teresa cousin like good, you have 35,000 sins against you. And you want to call yourself good? Because God's standard is no one will see the kingdom of heaven with any sin. That's why you and I, we need a Savior. Because no one on the face of this earth, not the best person in the world that you know, on their own can make it to God. No one on their own can be good enough for God. There is no one that on their own merit will arrive in heaven and say, whoa, I was really good. The gates of heaven are going to open and they're walking in. No one. They're shut for everyone except those that are cleansed and washed and forgiven by a sacrifice that is greater than them. And that's the sacrifice of the Son of God who died on a cross and gave himself for us. There is no other way. Some of you are doing penance. Some of you want to confess your sins to me. I don't want to hear your sins. I'm sorry. I'm not trying to be mean, but I don't want you to confess your sins to me. I don't have all day. Take a long time for some of you. And I'm not the one that died on the cross, and I'm not the one that has the power to forgive. There is one mediator between God and man, and that is the man Christ Jesus who died, who has the power to forgive and cleanse and make us new. Only one. Jesus, the Son of God, the perfect one. So some of you need to experience that forgiveness in your life, the cleansing. Some of you need to experience what only Jesus could do. If you're trying to save yourself, you are condemned already. If you're trying to be good enough for God, you've condemned yourself. If you haven't bowed your knee before a cross and say, I cannot save myself, I need a Savior. And there's only one Savior who was all God and all man and became the perfect sacrifice, the Lamb of sacrifice, Jesus the Christ, the Son of God, who you and I crucified. And then lastly, but not least, the Bible says that when we believe, repent, surrender to him as Lord and Savior, not only will we experience the forgiveness of sins, but we will receive the gift called the Holy Spirit. Let me tell you why the Holy Spirit is so important. Because even if you were clean, if you had no Holy Spirit, then you would go right back to the way you were living before. You need a power that's greater than you to change you. You need a power, the kind of power that rose Jesus from the dead, the third person of the Godhead, the power of God Himself renewing you from the inside out. Christianity is not a religion of white knuckling it to try to make it to God and living by a list of rules. Christianity is about a power greater than us, the power of God Himself coming to dwell inside of us and to change us from the inside out. It's called renewal, renovation, new birth. It's the indwelling of the Holy Spirit that only comes when our vessel is clean through the blood of Jesus Christ, and a power that's greater than us invades our body and gives us the power to start changing that which we could never change on our own. Listen, I'm trying to present the gospel as clearly as I can to you, because I don't want you to walk away and just say, that was a nice play. I want something more than that from you. Now, I can't force you, make you, but I can proclaim it. So that you, when you walk out of this place, you are without excuse. You can never say, I never heard. No one told me. I didn't know. No, I've proclaimed it and told it as clearly as I can. I've explained it and declared it as powerfully as I can, that you need a Savior. Without that Savior, you cannot have access to God. It's not about religion. It's about a relationship. You cannot have that relationship unless you repent, unless you surrender and receive Jesus as the Lord and Savior of your life, and you turn around and begin to follow Him as a disciple of Jesus the Christ, get baptized, receive the forgiveness of your sins, and the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. Some of you have been in church all of your life and you've never become a follower of Jesus. This has never happened to you. And to you, it's just religion that makes you feel guilty. But you've never had this dynamic, powerful, life-changing, transformative relationship with the one that forgives you, washes you, and fills you with the Holy Spirit. You have a purpose and a destiny that many of you have not even begun to live because you've never had that God encounter. Jesus said, unless you are born again, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. So I want to close this Easter Sunday this way. I'm not going to hand out Easter eggs. I'm not going to bless you. At the end, I'll pray a blessing over you. But I'm going to call you to something more. I pray that some would be cut to the heart. Cut to the heart means convicted, like, what should I do? Some of you have been asking yourself that question. If I am guilty of crucifying Jesus, then what shall I do? Repent. You have to believe and repent. Surrender your life to Christ. Invite Him in. Followed by the step of baptism as you receive the forgiveness of God and the power of the Holy Spirit to change you and make you a brand new person. I'm going to ask that you quietly stand with me. I don't want anybody walking around at this time. Your car will still be in the parking lot, and we've not sold your kids, believe me. I'm going to close with this on this Easter Sunday. You could end up this day eating a chocolate bunny, posting Instagram photos, Snapchat videos of how cute you looked. But I think it's deeper than that. I think it's more powerful than that, what God wants to do. We have a symbolic cross over here. I'm going to ask that we just bring the cross over here, right over here. And I'm going to ask at this time if we could have Pastor Tony right here. I'm going to ask Josiah to help me as well. Up here by the cross. And I'm going to give you an opportunity to respond today. If you're here today and you are cut in the heart, and you're saying, yeah, what should I do? And you realize that you're not living like a Christian. You're not living like a follower of Jesus Christ. And there's something inside of you that you know has been pushing you to make a change. You didn't expect to come to Easter and make any major decision. You just expected to show up and see a drama. But God wants more of you. God loves you. He's been following you and tracking you, even when you have been ignoring him. He's been calling out to you when your music has been so loud that you could barely hear his voice. He's been putting signs inside you, around you. He's been stirring up a discontentment with your life. He's been saying, there's more. There's more to it. I designed you, created you for something more than what you're living. I believe God is cutting some to the heart. And some of you are saying, yeah, what should I do? And yeah, I'm willing to repent. Follow up with whatever steps I need to take to follow Jesus. It starts with a prayer of surrender. That's how it starts. Our faith coming to God. I believe the Holy Spirit is here. The Spirit of the resurrected Jesus is in this place. You say, well, Jesus is alive. Where is he? He is here, present, with the power to change, save, deliver, and heal.